We're so delighted to have Michael Hill with us, and we'll be learning certainly more about him as time goes on. I'm Randy Sweeney, the Executive Director of the Chautauqua Region Community Foundation. If I haven't met you, I'd like to just recognize a few people that are here with us tonight. Jacqueline Phelps is here representing U.S. Assemblyman Tom Reed's office. Randy Holcomb's here representing Senator Kathy Young's office. Vince Horrigan, our Chautauqua County executive, is here also, and Mayor Sam Teresi is with us also. So we're thankful that they all had a moment to come and spend some time with us. Also, I'd like to recognize there's a large group from St. Bonaventure University, and we're certainly that they're happy they're here. Dr. Roth and Mrs. Roth are here. Dr. Roth is the interim president at St. Bonaventure University, and certainly we're delighted to have President Emeritus Sister Margaret Carney here also. And so, and also a number of other members from St. Bonaventure, their cabinet and board of trustees. As I said before, we're delighted to that Michael had time in his schedule, and I'm sure a lot of people are tugging at his coat right now looking for time. We're so blessed to have Chautauqua Institution just down the road from us, a major contributor both in the world of education and arts, and certainly that venue that allows discussions on many of the pertinent items of today. A place where they can be debated and discussed, and I'm sure that there'll be a legacy at some point down the road as Michael looks back at his wonderful time there. As you know, we're looking forward to a time here with Greg Peterson to interview Michael. But before we begin, there's a couple things that are going on that we found to be quite interesting. And yesterday, on January 9th, Michael Hill had a birthday. Not that that's, you know, but tomorrow, Greg Peterson has a birthday. So I don't know, Don, could you get us started in happy birthday to these two guys? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Greg and Michael. Happy birthday to you.
And doing my due diligence, that means you're a Capricorn. And your horoscope, as am I, for the January 9th says, your adaptability, charm, and work ethic are amongst your most defining qualities. While many people become overwhelmed with new people or in new environments, you take to new experiences with excitement. People are quickly won over by your charm, wit, and warm personality, which explains how you have managed to start so many friendships over the years. While your friends and family love you for your sociability, they may most greatly admire your hardworking personality. When you meet a worthwhile goal, you will work tirelessly to accomplish it.
I'd like to thank our foundation for writing the horoscope for that day.
Sounds great. Fantastic. You should sign on to this. And by the way,
did you pull yours?
Yes, I did.
Okay, what does it say?
Yeah, well, it's defined as loyal and disciplined personality, although you may not be the most outgoing person in every setting.
That's not what I hear.
Nobody would believe that. So this mine's probably debunked right away. By the way, our ruling planet is Saturn, in case you're curious.
All right.
So, you know, you're a St. Bonaventure guy.
Absolutely.
And the most telling thing that happened today, and maybe will happen tonight, is the fact that our new president of Chautauqua Institution, and welcome, he's there doing a selfie. He's a 43-year-old. is it Next Gen? Is that your group? Is that the group that you fit when you fit 43? Is that a...
Now Gen?
Thank you.
He's there holding up his iPhone and taking a selfie with Sister Margaret.
Of course. It's not the first selfie I've taken with Sister Margaret.
That was so cool. That's terrific. Now, talk to me about what Sister Margaret means to Michael Hill.
Well, I would like to say that you can't claim that I'm the one taking the selfie. I think Sister Margaret provokes the selfies. So, I mean, she, If you've seen any of the images of her with students, she's 18 times cooler than I will ever be. Margaret and I go way, way back. There's a funny story. When we both showed up on campus, we were both working for the then president, and we were the only two directors that reported to the president. So we'd call each other the other director and meet in mid-campus and had lots of adventures together. And then one of the greatest honors outside of being named the 18th president of Chautauqua was being named to the board of trustees of my alma mater. And so I had a chance to see up close the incredible grace and dignity and leadership of Sister Margaret. And I think for anyone that has had the benefit of seeing that, it's certainly an example of leadership that I could only hope to emulate. So I'm grateful to see her here. It'll probably get the most likes of anything I put on Facebook today, yeah. Or this week, for that matter.
Why did you go to St. Bonaventure?
You know, so I was telling someone at Chautauqua this story. I was raised Catholic, and like many small Catholic parishes, I think as you're a young person, by the time
you were raised in upstate Norfolk?
Upstate New York, yeah, small, small town.
What was it called, Norfolk?
Norfolk, yeah, and most of us, I think you go through the identity crisis as a Catholic where you're like, I'm not going to go to a Catholic school. My parents can't make me. And guidance counselor, when I said I wanted to be a journalist, said, you need to go to St. Bonaventure. I said, I'm not going to Catholic school. And that sly guidance counselor said, fine, don't go to a Catholic school, but go to Communications Day and take the student newspaper, of which I was the editor there. And I stepped on foot on the campus at 17 and applied nowhere else. And it started one of the greatest love affairs of my life.
You chose a path in communication. Was that something that your parents had kind of, were they in that business?
I don't think anyone's mom says, go be a journalist. Unless your mom is a journalist. You know, my mom wanted me to do the stereotypical things, be a doctor, be a lawyer, do something like that. But I had learned that writing was an avenue into a lot of things that I really cared about. And so Bonaventure was a perfect place for me to go. It's for years and continues to have one of the best journalism programs in the country, and I received an outstanding education there.
And you received an outstanding award, too. As your senior, you got an award which you went to New York City to receive.
I did, and actually, a neat factoid, our current director of communications, Jordan Steves, got the same award, so we like to boast that we're Hellinger Award winners. What I love about that award, though, is that at the end of my time at St. Bonaventure, I had decided that I really wanted to spend more time in the arts than in journalism. And if you've ever met any member of our journalism faculty who are convinced they are steering you toward a career in journalism, to say, I'm not going to do that, was the worst thing that my advisor could hear. So she sent me to Chautauqua, actually thinking that I would be an arts journalist and she would save my journalism career, which started my work history with Chautauqua. And when I won that award, I had decided to go get my master's degree in arts and culture management. And to her great credit, she said, well, the Hellinger Award recognizes an outstanding prospective journalist, but Mark Hellinger was also a Broadway producer and playwright. And so perhaps you can merge the two and find a way to talk yourself out of that speech at the Plaza. So she saved me in that regard.
I must confess that when we sent out a notice to a variety of folks that we were going to have this opportunity to talk, I got a phone call from an individual who was sitting on a beach in Florida and saying, when you interview Michael Hill, remind him of that award. And remind him that who was the dean of journalism
at
that
time. Oh, Lee Coppola.
And that, in fact, what instructions he gave you giving your acceptance speech. So that's a guide. Why don't you talk to them? Tell them what Lee said to you.
Well, Lee reminded me to be brief, as only Lee could. Lee ended up being the dean of the journalism school the year after I left, so it was his first time giving out those awards. And then Lee and I had a fun tug of war because a number of the journalism students had wanted to do senior theses capstones around arts events, and he called me one day and said, why are all the journalists doing arts program activities? We need to stop that. So Lee and I had a great banter and tug and pull for a long time. And then I ended up having the opportunity to MC the Hellinger Awards in Washington a couple of years ago. And I reminded Lee that he could not keep me brief in that moment because I was now in charge of the podium. So it was a great full circle moment.
Yeah, he was reminding me of the 5-minute rule. I didn't understand it. So you went to Mount St. Mary's after St. Bonaventure, and that was to get your master's.
St. Mary's in Minnesota.
Okay. And that was a master's in what?
Arts and cultural management.
Okay. And you actually went back to St. Bonaventure, didn't you?
I did. Yeah, I went back for what was supposed to be a year that turned five or six.
What'd you do there?
I came back initially as their director of theater programming and their assistant director, and ultimately ended up being the director of their art center. And it was a dynamic time at Bonaventure. And one of the things that I'll say that reminds me of Sister Margaret is we were encouraged at that point to dream and build things. And so we spent a lot of time building things together, and that center grew exponentially, including from people from Jamestown. I mean, that's where I first met Betty Lene, who was unbelievably generous, and others in the region that helped us really build a cultural center on campus. And it was a fantastic way to start one's career.
Did I tell you Betty Lene also helped us start the Jackson Center?
You did.
Just a pure serendipity. But as you were choosing your career, it was important that this horoscope guided you. This is really good stuff. In choosing a career, if in fact you were born January 9th, which you were, although choosing a career is always easier said than done, your natural abilities are well suited for several career paths. Your social needs and creativity may take you into fields such as teaching, business, marketing, or promotions, and you are a marketer. Similarly, your determination would be well suited for the world of finance or science. If you are musically inclined, you may find fulfillment as a singer or a lyricist, which was the case of Dave Matthews, just to drop a name, who was born on January 9th. In whichever career you choose, maintain warmth, generosity, and compassion, much like Kay Middleton, just to drop a name, another of your celebrity birthday twins. Now, when you were at St. Bonaventure, you were involved in music in, I don't want to say cantor, but did you? It was.
I did cantor at Mass, yeah. Yeah, I was a cantor at our weekly Masses and participated some in community theater as well.
Will you be singing quite a bit at Chautauqua?
I don't know that that's on the docket of activities. And I would also say those that we invite to do that probably do it far better. So I'll leave it to the professionals.
Do you have a genre which you enjoy? So when you're home and you kick off the shoes and put on the slippers, what do you turn on?
I'm a jazz guy.
Yeah.
And I love the female vocalists that really harken back to a time when that part of melody and song were popular. My favorite jazz artist is a woman named Jane Monheit, who is in her early 30s, and her husband is her percussionist, and she has somehow found a way to tour the country with their now four-year-old. Just fantastic.
Does somebody share? Have you make a note of this here? Were you involved in choral activities there? Was it at St. Bonaventure?
It was mostly through Masses. There was and is a concert choir there. I was and am a trombonist, and so I spent most of my musical time as a student playing the trombone in pep band and jazz band and concert band. And then when I went back to run the Art Center, there was actually for a time a trombone choir, and I participated in that as an administrator and really had a great deal of fun connecting with the students that were using the Art Center that way.
Chautauqua, 1996, you get a job at the Chautauqua Daily.
Yeah.
What was your first assignment?
Well, I was actually a copy editor and quasi-assistant editor, and so one of the interesting things was that I was stuck in the newsroom while these reporters were going out to cover this amazing programming, which I found unbelievably frustrating. But it was neat to see all of the different work come back in and then take what I had learned at Bonaventure and try to polish it every day. I remind Jordan Steeves again, you know, that he had the same first job as I did, and I kind of want to keep this one for a while, so he shouldn't think of bumping me off of the presidency too soon. There's a strong lineage of people that worked at the Daily that ended up doing other things there, and I think it's because it's one of the perches where you get a view into everything that incredible institution has to offer, mm-hmm. because we're trying to write about it all. Ironically, as I was looking at the opportunity to come back to Chautauqua, I found a headline that was a gift to me. It was the last headline I had constructed that the editor at the time gave me as a farewell gift. And for some reason, I saved it. And the headline was, "Understanding God Never Reaches Final Destination." And she wrote on the top of it, "Life is just one headline after another, isn't it?"
But you came back for another year or two, didn't you, at the Daily?
No, I was at the Daily for a year, then I went up to do graduate school, and then I was fortunate enough to come back as a guest critic on occasion. So when I was at St. Bonaventure, and I was laughing with Jordan the other day, never let an early 20-something be a critic of the arts, because some of the obnoxious things I thought I had a right to say, at 23 about some incredible master artists that were on the stage make me cringe. I'm hoping they stay buried. Jordan, please burn them. But no, it was an amazing experience to come back and to get invited to participate in the dialogue of that place through criticism.
So, well, speaking of criticism and you being a critic, what did you learn about the Chautauqua mentality in that being that moment of time?
Well, thank you for that question. No, I think what I would say...
Maureen asked me to ask that, okay? I just want you to...
Thanks for waving and smiling. No, one of the great things about Chautauqua is that people who are intellectually hungry and curious go there. And so if you're a critic, you get to participate in a place that is all about dialogue and debate. And so that was my first real peek into Chautauquans who hold a variety of opinions on any topic and like to hash those around together. And it's one of the things I'm grateful has never left that institution. I think it's unfortunately something that's left our national dialogue. And it's one of the unique things I think Chautauqua can do in restoring civility and discourse in our nation. And it's one of the reasons, honestly, that I came back, because I think it's so necessary. And I'm proud that it's here.
Yeah. Well, we're glad you're here. When you're reading your resume, promotion, marketing, development are all part of that fabric of Michael Hill. And it really started the show itself as when you were at the arena stage.
Yeah.
You raised more money for that than it had heretofore.
Yeah, that was an exciting project. Arena Stage was one of the first regional theaters in the country, and it had a series of firsts that
Where was it located, just for the audience?
It's in Southwest Washington, right on the waterfront, in an area that at the time had really been forgotten. So Route 395 had cut that part of the city off from the life of the rest of the city. And the theater was founded by Zelda Fitchhandler and Tom Fitchhandler, and had notably some firsts that it should and could be proud of, which it was the first racially integrated cast, James Earl Jones and the Great White Hope. It was the first regional theater company to go behind the Iron Curtain. Our town went and toured Russia and the Soviet Union, but it had fallen behind in times. And even though the two buildings were national historic landmarks because they were designed and built by the gentleman that designed the metro system, they were really decaying, and so the campaign called for a reimagining of that space. And to this day, because it was so hard, to be honest, it was an unbelievably dynamic time, I still get chills when I walk into that building.
At one point, do you say, I've succeeded in something which had heretofore not occurred, and you kind of moved on? Is that hard to do when you've had such successes?
You know, I've loved each of the parts of my journey that I've had, and I've moved on because I've had an opportunity to do something that I've cared about. And so as I look at where I've been in my career, I'd love to claim skill in any of it. It's just been a series of serendipitous moments where I've been asked to participate in something that I care about, and I feel really lucky to have been able to do that. And I think this is potentially the penultimate expression of that, to come back here. I said this to a community gathering at the library yesterday. History matters a lot to me. And when you look at the lineage of presidents, and I know we share in common Dan Bratton. Dan Bratton was this removed hero to me as a daily person. He was this intellectual giant that rightfully presided over that institution. And to be in a line of lineage with Dan Bratton still makes me pinch myself on most days.
How would your paths would have crossed Dan's?
Dan, I would have likely have seen him on the occasion that he would have popped into the Daily, and then I would have watched him in several expressions when I was able to sneak into AMP programs or other things. I'm trying to anticipate the pace of what it's like to be present there, and I'm told that you sprint around a lot, and I often watch Dan sprinting around the grounds a lot and hope to figure out a similar cadence.
After the arena, the stage arena, where was next?
I went from Arena Stage to the National Cathedral. And I was just talking to our director of religion about this today. I had been at the arena for about 5 years, and it was clear that we were going to be able to build the building, which I was excited about. And our campaign consultant was asked to go up as associate dean, so the head of the cathedral is a dean for those that aren't Episcopalians. And she said, there's this guy, Sam Lloyd, from Trinity Boston, who wants to start a new conversation about Christianity, that it's gone too far to the extremes. And are you interested in helping us create a new movement of what he was calling generous-spirited Christianity? And it was the belief that we were never really going to get to solving the world's problems if we sat at the polar opposites of any ideology. And, you know, would I come help create a movement? And so I went to that iconic place to try to help create a movement.
How difficult was it to bring disparate interest to a common core value?
I think it's incredibly difficult. I think it's what we still wrestle with today. Sam, in his first year, decided to bring the former president of Iran to have a conversation with a Roman Catholic cardinal and a rabbi. And most of us were under death threats for those 2 or 3 weeks that that was happening. But he believed if you didn't dramatically drive dialogue with people that symbolically may be at the polar opposites, and that we were never going to get to any of the issues that were really strangling the world. And for the 3.5-4 years I was with Sam, he was incredibly thoughtful and prayerful about trying to do that. It was an unbelievably dynamic time to be there.
You also took time with the Washington Ballet.
I did. I went to the ballet to work with Septime Weber, who believed that the arts should be used as a tool to help those that were less fortunate. It was helping to build facilities in Anacostia and doing deep outreach. I sit on the board still of something called the Sitar Arts Center, which is for kids in the district who are below the poverty line. So 97% of all the participants that go through that center wouldn't have arts and education opportunities. And Septime Weber put professional ballet teachers in that facility. He tugged on my Franciscan heart quite a bit. And it was neat to watch him intentionally use the arts to try to elevate a community. It's something I think we need to do more of here. It's something that I was grateful that Bonaventure allowed me to do with arts and education, and it's something that we've started to have conversations more about at Chautauqua. It does quite a bit, but I think the resource of the Chautauqua Institution should have a role, actually has an obligation at raising the opportunities that are available to young people in the region.
Fantastic. United Cerebral Palsy then calls.
Yeah, so perhaps a more obscure part of my life is I have a special needs uncle. He has Down syndrome and autism. And growing up, he was simply my uncle. But I watched, in particular after my grandmother passed, what it was like to try to help him live his life to the fullest possibilities. And a gentleman who I had served on an arts board with was the CEO there for a long time, and made a very compelling case. He said, and I think this is still true, that for people with disabilities, it may be the last great civil rights movement. That if you look at the advances that have been made for so many others, I think it's a crime that we passed the Americans with Disabilities Act and people think we're done. Mm-hmm. And there are too many barriers left for people with disabilities. And so Steve Bennett asked me to come help try to rewrite that story and to find resources for parents and families that had a special needs or a person with disability in their family, and it was a lot of fun.
We have a very, by the way, just a personal sidebar, we're blessed here in Chautauqua County to have a very active resource center which deals with developmentally disabled folks, and at some point, given your interest, we should at least introduce you to that. Youth for Understanding is next, but let me just pause for a second because online...
Do you have another horoscope?
I've learned so much about you without even... You have no idea what the rest of this day is going to be. So, Sterling and Martin Associates put out a case study. Youth for Understanding USA President and Chief Executive Officer. Youth for Understanding is a global network of nonprofit educational organizations operating programs across 64 countries. The challenge, Sterling Martin was engaged by the Youth for Understanding to search for a president and CEO to replace the previous executive who left the organization after 18 years of service. We learned on that YFU-USA was viewed by many as being somewhat dysfunctional. We found the resource generation and fundraising were major challenges, and the current business model needed to be overhauled. The organization was stuck in the past, not yet crossed the 21st century. The solution, following a national search, our placement was Michael Hill, an experienced international nonprofit executive. Michael came to the Youth for Understanding from United Cerebral Palsy, where he served as senior vice president, was responsible for leading the international public education, and then goes on to talk about how fantastic you are. It also said that Hill's appointment came with a mandate from the governing board to radically re-energize the organization. Under Hill's leadership, the organization's website and marketing materials have been overhauled, key senior leadership appointments have been made, a student scholarship program has been initiated, the staff and volunteer structures have been reorganized and re-energized, yada, 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 and how great thou art.
oh, Lord my God.
Yeah. Is that true?
Well, so remember, Sterling Martin wants to get hired again to find another, you know, second coming of something. No, I think their description of what I found at Youth for Understanding is true. I think that a team of people did what they describe I did. And that's always been my philosophy. I found an unbelievably committed group of people, and I brought some others along that helped. And I think much like Chautauqua, the mission was and is unbelievably poignant in these times. And part of what I most enjoy doing, which harkens back to my Bonaventure education, is helping find ways to tell stories that bring people closer to missions. And Youth for Understanding has an unbelievable one.
And you were there for how long?
Almost 4 years.
4 years?
Until this place came calling.
Talk about that. How did they come calling? How did they find you?
So I laughed with friends who knew I was from here, and I said there are only two jobs that would have me come back at this point in my life to Western New York. One I was academically not qualified to do, and that's serving as president of St. Bonaventure University. And the other one was the Chautauqua Institution. And I had followed Tom's trajectory, and honestly, I thought there was at least another 5, 6, 7 years that Tom would be around. So it became a fun musing of, you know, when Tom Becker leaves, maybe. I just thought that would be several more years off. When Tom announced his retirement, there's a board colleague of mine at Bonaventure who said, you should do this. And to be quite honest, we were doing so many dynamic things at Youth for Understanding that for the first 3 to 4 months, the answer was, no way. You know, I'm not leaving the work that I'm doing. It was an unbelievably interesting search process that at the tail end had me realizing that when I said there's only two jobs that would bring me back, when this one came calling, there was no way to say no.
Talk about the process, because I must tell you, I bet there's nobody here. With all those who were involved at Chautauqua, and it was a parlor game all summer.
It was.
Right?
It was.
Right? Huh? How about that, right? Nobody
yeah.
had a clue. And it was the best kept secret till you were announced. Poof, they were off to Michael Hill. And I can say that because Susan Murphy's right here. She's the boss of George wouldn't tell her anything.
Yep.
And so, let's talk about the process. I mean, you can talk about it now. It's okay.
Yeah. Oh, thanks. No, it was. And as candidates, from the first time we showed up in an interview, they were very clear that they were running an extremely closed process, including this was the best perk I'd ever received in an interview, and the most bizarre moment was, we'd like you to go spend some time at Chautauqua. It's on us. Just go enjoy it. And I thought, when do you get to interview for a job? And like, go to the Chautauqua Institution and just be. Wow, that's fantastic. And if you see any members of the search committee, pretend you don't know us. Okay. You know, and I had been on Chautauqua enough. It's like, and you know, pray you don't run into anyone you do know. And I did run into Maureen Ravenio and tried to be like, nope, I'm just here visiting. I don't know what, you know. Just taking in lectures, because that's what one does at Chautauqua. It's good. I'm fine. And then even when I came back for what a couple of the board members call election weekend, where the board actually meets and elects the president, I stayed in the board chair's house, and I laughed at him because he had me in the room on the third floor in the attic. And I said, you know, at some point, is it going to stop being a secret? And then as boards are wont to do, and I know because I sit on one, and certainly we've tormented Dr. Roth and Margaret enough in this process, they're like, just go in this room with the fireplace, and it'll be like 10 or 15 minutes. hour and a half goes by, and emissaries from the border come out going, it's okay, we're just debating process. And I said, well, you do realize I resigned my other job yesterday. So I'm kind of hoping that if we're just debating process, that it turns out in a real offer. And that's when the games began of being public. The funny story, and I've shared with a number of people at Chautauqua, was they were so secretive that when they decided that they thought I was maybe kind of their guy, I was referred to in emails as candidate 1A. And so, you know, and the search firm was getting really kind of cheeky. They'd write to me and they're like, dear 1A. So I said to Jim Porter, our board chair, as we were going into, again, election weekend, I said, you know, I'm fine with being 1A, but I would much rather flop that out for 18. Yeah, yeah. So, you know, at some point I want the jersey that says, you know, CHQ 18, because I was getting a little complex about 1A, you know, just begs, is there 1B, is there 1C? So it was a very interesting process. And to the institution and its search committee's credit, not even their spouses knew. So that weekend I got to go out to dinner with the search committee members' spouses. And they said, well, finally, we get to know who you are. And we tried, you know, everything. We tried giving them wine. We tried, you know, anything that would, and they just said, no, we can't say anything. So kudos to them.
When's the first time you met Tom Becker that you knew that you were going to be the guy?
Oh, so there's two funny stories on that. So I'm up for an interview that happened at Peak and Peak. And I'm staying in a friend's house. I'm staying in Laurie Branch's house on the grounds. And I'm there for maybe a day. At this point, I'm thinking it should be empty enough, except that's the weekend that Tom is getting feted by the board at a big dinner. So I'm walking down Bester Plaza, and I see Tom getting ready to go into the bookstore. Well, of course, Tom's been there so long, he knows almost everyone in the community. And he locks eyes with me, and I'm thinking, he knows. You know, because who is that guy? And I don't know him. So I quickly darted down a side street to try to keep things on the up and up. But then two things happened. One was Tom called me when the board let him know that I was going to go from 1A to 18, and we had a really lovely conversation. And then we went out to dinner together on that weekend. And I have to say, Tom, through that whole process of transition, has been just beyond gracious to me. We've actually developed a friendship in the process, and there's nothing I think I could ask him to do that he wouldn't do, and I'm grateful for that. I mean, to follow someone that's had that length of tenure and to have him be as kind and generous to me is a real reflection of his character.
Well, his character displayed itself to me personally because of you. So I take Tom as my guest. You may know that he's a Chicago Cubs fan. And because Tom, probably because he resigned, the Cubs win. I mean, it's that simple. So I took him as my guest to the first game of the World Series in Cleveland. Mm. So Tom's wearing his Cubs hat, Tom's wearing his Cubs jacket, Cubs underwear, you name it, he's got it. And we're cruising down the road, and he had just talked to you. Mm. But he wouldn't mention your name and anything else. I said, Tom, it's okay. I'm not going to press you. What's his name? you know, male or female? Just give me something. But he talked about attributes, but never even talked about even the gender. So the rest of the week proceeds in the World Series, and I have tickets for Game 7. Oh. Game 7. So I call Tom because, you know, here's this guy. He's Mr. Cubs and chance of a lifetime. And I asked him, I said, you want to be my guest for Game 7? And he says, no, I'm looking forward to having dinner with one Michael Hill. Mm-hmm. So he had dinner with you, and he chose that as a principal over going to see the Cubs. And I don't think he regrets it, maybe yet.
Well, I'll share a funny story with you. So we're sitting in Webb's, and the only caveat Tom said was, there's a big TV over there. I mean, if we could just kind of position ourselves right here. So, you know, I'm trying to glean hints from Tom on how does one do this. And he goes, And at some point, he looks at me and he goes, I'm going to do the Irish goodbye, but I'm going to tell you. He said, you don't need me here anymore. And he floats backwards. He says, I'm going to watch the game. So, but he did. He gave up the tickets, which is
he did, yeah.
Really
he gracious. Texted me throughout saying, he's a nice guy. You know, you like that. So you're now here, but what did you anticipate as you were going through the process What questions were you asking Chautauquan search committee members?
Well, you know,
and I don't want to defy and belie any confidences, but if it's a curiosity, what your thought?
Well, you know, and I'm sure Andy Roth feels this palpably. When you go to a store, to an institution that has the history that Chautauqua has, there's always the question about where does it want to go next, right? And that's not as simple as new president comes in and he or she can take it anywhere they want, because there's a legacy and a history that has to be honored. And in Chautauqua's case, there's a community that calls that place home some year round, some seasonally, but feels that it's its own home. And so the questions for me really were, how far did the institution want to stretch from what it's already doing? What did it see as its role in the future dialogue of this country? And the answers, which I won't betray because there's more things for us to share and to release later, is that it really is an institution that I think envisions not only celebrating its history, but using that history to play a significant role, as it has so many times in its history, to shape a dialogue in the country. And I couldn't be more excited about that.
You recently were on a presidential search as a board member.
I was.
What was that like, having just gone through one for yourself personally, and then at the same time doing the same thing at St. Bonaventure?
Well, I would have to say it's a lot more fun to be on the other side. I had unbelievable empathy for the candidates going through that search. And Bonaventure did a relatively close search. So it was also understanding anew why that mattered. But in addition to picking a president for my alma mater, we were picking a partner, right? Because I believe firmly that the pillar institutions in Western New York have to cooperate more. It's one of the reasons I'm excited that we're here. And, you know, we share a lot and have done a lot together. I know that the center is now doing work with St. Bonaventure. And I think the more that the pillar institutions in Western New York can operate together to elevate this entire region, the better. So it was interesting perspective, because of course I care as an alum, and I'm answerable to friends on the outside who were doing to me what you were doing to Tom. Oh, come on, just whisper who the candidates are. But I also knew I was picking a partner for the region, and couldn't be happier that Dennis DePiro came out the other side.
When did you know that you were going to be the recommendation of the committee at Chautauqua?
I knew probably 10 to 11 days before I showed up on the grounds for that weekend. But again, they were, because that board was getting the first real deep dive debrief, and there could have been an opportunity where they said, glad that the six of you think that this is the guy, but we don't. So 1A for 7 to 10 days was pretty real for me.
Chautauqua has an awful lot of fascinating, interesting, stakeholder-type people. Have you had much where they'd like to kind of... I don't know how I'd be... I'm trying to do this politely. Have you had a lot... Now I know there's just where they would like to say, hey, come on, let's go off and have lunch and dinner, and I'd like to bend your ear. Have you had much of that yet?
Yes. I loved the description that one of the search committee members gave me. So there were two things they said, both of which I'm starting to feel palpably. One was from a person who had run a Fortune 10 company. And he said, you know, for all of the complexities of what I had to deal with, I think Chautauqua is more complex. I think he's right. The other one was trying to describe the multiple hats that the president of that institution wears. And the one that I think I'm living out most now, because I think this period of time is really getting to know the resident community that's there year-round, and I'm living there year-round in the president's cottage, is that of de facto mayor of this small town. What I wasn't prepared for was that everyone knows where your house is, and and they'll knock. So I'm learning that, you know, perhaps wearing one's pajamas on a weekend may not be what one should wear when the doorbell rings on a Sunday morning. So we'll figure that out, figure out how to navigate the house.
Yeah. Does Don Greenhouse do that a lot?
Yeah. Only twice.
So you're now ensconced. Have you also learned, what have you learned about the community, this community here? I mean, many people are from the community.
Right.
And they're just anxious as all get out to meet the head of Chautauqua, which in our mind's eye is really the asset in our community. Jackson Center notwithstanding. But, you know.
We can share it.
That's okay. Yeah, you can share. But nevertheless, what have you learned about us?
Well, you know, I always like to, I said to the group yesterday in the library, my favorite greeting is welcome home, because Western New York is not new to me. Mm-hmm. I lived here before I went to Washington. Or as some have said, I just had that meandering, I got lost somewhere in the swamps of the Potomac for 15 years trying to get out and finally came back. So the warmth and caring of the community hasn't changed, and I'm grateful for that. One of my favorite stories when I was living in Olean was, you know, you have John Ash Cleaners, and when I try to describe to people what small town living is like, I said, you know, I would go try to pick up my dry cleaning, realize I had forgotten my wallet, and John Ash would say, "Oh, just catch me at Tops. We'll catch up with each other." And for me, that's symbolic of just how close-knit our communities are. And so I'm grateful to have found that again here, and grateful that that hasn't gone away in the time that I've been away. I think what's interesting for me specific to Chautauqua is, short of a couple of visits in the fall, I've never lived there off-season. So I had a vision of what the grounds were like in those specific, you know, 9 or 10 weeks. And I've been so pleasantly surprised at how lovely it is to have a resident community when it's just a little bit slower. And I'm told that I will look back on these months and cherish and long for them once the season starts. And I've been told to get a bicycle, because if I want to get across the grounds in any less than 5 hours, I better perfect the Tom Becker wave from the bike. So anyone that's biked around Chautauqua, if you have specific recommendations of types of bikes, let me know.
Well, you know, there's a great program during the off season at Turner School twice a month. We'll tell you all about that. Right, isn't that not part of the great experience of Chautauqua? And this is tonight's, by the way. The one we normally would have had up there is tonight. This is right. Okay. Here, right now. What do you hope to learn? You, at this point, as you here it is, January 10th, a day after your 43rd birthday. And as you look down, and you hopefully as you get into May, June, your agenda just saying, I'm looking forward to my first year. I'm looking forward to my first speech, my first three taps of the gavel. What do you hope that you haven't got to feel like you got to fill in over the next 4 or 5 months?
Well, I think the beauty of the job is that I'm never going to learn everything I need to know to do that job. And I think that's, for someone who's intellectually curious, that's one of the great gifts that Chautauqua will give to me for years to come, is every time I think I've got, at least in my mind, the different groups that are there and what they care about, someone says, oh, have you heard about? And it's, oh, no, I haven't heard about that one. So these months really is getting reconnected to the community and to the region. I think it's a great luxury to know those that are here off season and feel like I've joined their community. So that as I go into then greeting the throngs of Chautauquans who come back for the summer season, I feel like I've got, you know, a base of people. So I'm looking forward to taking the time to do that. I also know Jeff is in the audience and is reminding me that Chautauquans are everywhere, so I'm going to be on a plane quite a bit and visiting Chautauquans who aren't as hardy as you all in dealing with the wintry months here in Western New York, and I'm looking forward to hearing about that. You know, everyone's favorite question is, what's your vision? And I think so much of what I need to do in this first year is hearing, why did you come and why do you care? Because certainly there will be a new expression of a vision that comes with a new president. That happens all the time. But what can't go away is why people love this sacred place. And before I start making radical decisions, I need to really understand what it is that matters most to people that have called that institution home longer than my 20 years. I mean, the summer marks my 20th year since I first came. It's the only place I know where 20 years, and you know, you don't even count as a baby or a rookie. You know, it's you'll catch up eventually, and we'll consider you serious when you hit 50. You know, that's
all true. Have you learned kind of as the demographics have changed, as the ability to do basic metrics of Chautauqua, and I know that's been a focal point of Tom's and maybe Dan's earlier than that, but to learn more about why people come. What have you learned over the last 10 years as far as trends and why people do come? Not why they will come, but why they do come.
Well, I think one of the challenges and opportunities for the institution is that for decades, it was primarily comprised of multi-generational families that came and stayed for 9 weeks. And society is really putting pressure on that model for us. It's not to say that those that still do that aren't honored and beloved and valued, because they are. And I hope we add more people to those ranks. But we're starting to see those that can only come for 1 or 2 weeks, or those that can only stop for 1 or 2 days. And I think for the challenge of the institution is, how do you incorporate those people, give them the same deep engagement that Chautauquans have loved for generations, and still have the 9-week conversation happen in ways that are meaningful for those that are still doing that. I think there's wonderful opportunities. One of the things that I've been chatting with trustees about, but also community members, is they keep saying, well, you know, gosh, young people won't come here, or they won't come to this region. And I have never bought that. I am so tired of our region apologizing for its location. I think it's an unbelievable asset. And if you look at the studies of younger generations, and I would say this having spent 4 years talking to a couple thousand kids from around the world every year, what younger generations are yearning for is trying to understand a complex world. They're desperate for relationship, which technology is taking them from. And they would like, they don't call it this, but they would like a sense of contemplation and a way to slow down. Now, if we can figure out a way to package that which already happens there to a generation who says, you know what, perhaps it's moving too fast for me, I think we have a really good chance of bringing in a new group of young people to have those conversations. And that's not to say we don't want the people there that are having those conversations, but I think the conversation gets more dynamic as we diversify a whole host of folks coming in there to have a dialogue.
What do you expect to happen tonight?
Well, I was warned about you. No. What I was warned
Pray
about...
Pray tell!
What I was warned about that has come to be true is that, you know, your journalism training is certainly coming through. The factoids you found out. You found Lee Coppola. Oh, God.
He found me.
I'll get Lee for that later. No, I expected what I found in community gatherings, which is it's so wonderful to walk into a room where you've been named the president of something that matters so much to people. That affirms the choice to come back. It's also underscores the awesome responsibility, because I think underlying all of the we love the places, the don't mess it up, right? So I feel that palpably, and thank you to all of you for making me feel that even more deeply today. But it emboldens me because the love for the institution is so strong, and the need for it in this region is so great. And so I had hoped to feel that tonight. I did feel that, and that actually just makes me more excited to go back to work tomorrow.
That's terrific, because we want you to work tomorrow, because we know you're going to do a great job. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome, Mike Williams. And if you want to watch Michael eat his cake, come down and say hello to him.
No, my cake was given to the birthday girl. So
mine, maybe. Well, thanks so much, Mike.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming, everybody.
Thank you.